Good morning and welcome to Chatham Citadel. Great to welcome you this morning. A church that is bringing people to Christ and Christ to people. I hope you're well. Another week. Where's that week gone? When we think about it, where has it gone? But I'm glad you're joining with us this morning. Later we will be praying, as always, and the number is on the screen. And just drop us a line. We've had some great prayers through and we've had some great encouragement. But maybe this morning you've never done it. Maybe this morning is the morning that you say, yeah, I want to know. I want to speak. I want to pray for me. I won't mention your name if you don't need to. So keeping in touch, just to remind you, the Chatham Chatter, it's emailed to you every week. You should have yours. Let me know if you do want it and it will be sent to you. And then our flower list, our virtual flower list, is back again this week. And we celebrate with Majors Peter and Estelle Clack on their 51st wedding anniversary. I don't know who needs the medal, whether it's Peter or Estelle, or we do a double medal. But congratulations to them, and also to our own divisional leaders, Majors Mark and Linda Herbert, who celebrate 33 years of wedded bliss. Is that the word, Mark? I'm sure it is, Linda would say. But congratulations to them both in exampling not just good Christian leadership, but also good Christian marriage. Thank you, and God bless you both today. Serving our young people, you'll see the address on the screen to download the sheet so the young people today can engage with Sunday school. And there is a youth cell today at 4 p.m. Last week, we know it was Pentecost. And if you remember, if you cast your minds back, it was bring your pet to Pentecost. Now, what could go wrong? And here are a few pictures of last week. There was Hetty the guinea pig. There were a few rabbits. There was a dog. There was caterpillars. And of course, there was Monty the python. I need to say that I tuned in for this bit because I thought, let's just see. And it was great to see Iris Wells there with the youngsters. She's a great supporter. And I would have thought, looking at her face, that the python was in her house. It was quite a good moment, sort of, yeah. But it was, the expression. And I couldn't tell you why we took our pets to Pentecost. But I can't wait till Pentecost next week. And we bring them next year, sorry. And we can bring them to church. I wonder how many will come when Monty comes as well. Hey, but it was great. Well done, young people. And then serving our young people, there's Sunday school again today at 11:30. And as I said, there's cell church at 4 p.m. Remind you about the Salvation Army papers. Have you got yours? You can get them on a yearly subscription. But if you are local, we can let you have one. The people who come in for the Bags of Hope here, they get a paper. And the youngsters get a Kids Alive that come in, which is really great. Talking about the Bags of Hope, we continue to do them. And providing dinners for the vulnerable. So much going on. And I was working out this week because we were talking to a few people of what's going on around the territory. And we're quite busy, as with a number of other Salvation Army centres across the UK. I worked out that when we're open, that we give out a bag of hope every 90 seconds. And that's quite amazing. That is quite amazing. And since the lockdown and since we started Bags of Hope, we've given over 1,500 bags of hope, bags of groceries to people in the Medway towns. And yeah, it's great. And I'm continually grateful to Morrison's, Booker Cash and Carrie, and Tesco's for their donations and what they give us, because it enables us to keep our budget down, but give out much needed stuff. So I am grateful to them. So when you're in Morrison's, just thank them. Say the Salvation Army said thank you. It's really worthwhile, and Tesco's. And also Medway Sunlight Rotary Club for their support and deliveries. They're here on Mondays, and they're delivering about 20 parcels to those who are shielding, those who can't get out at all or have nobody to do it. And so we drop parcels off to them, and also for DHQ for their continued support. So I'm really grateful for all that work that's going on and for all the extra parts that people are playing in supporting me. You know, some couples doing the Salvation Army papers now and delivering those. I'm grateful. People picking up the food from Tesco's and Booker's when asked. People helping to unload the van when it arrives. I'm so grateful for that, because it was a long 10 weeks. But God is our strength, isn't he? He really is. And I'm grateful for that. But I'm grateful for the support I'm getting. Not that I wasn't getting it before, but I've now asked more, and more are doing it. And now pictures from last week. I've just put this up because I'm grateful to our Sergeant Major and Wendy and the gang who provided afternoon tea to some of our folks in the Corps shielding. Just turn up at the door, and you can see here's Major Clack with his tea trolley. And they were so grateful. Had some messages, some beautiful messages. And I'm grateful for them for doing that. And I think a few more, they'll do it again. And we've heard messages coming through of people just really in tears, because it was just so lovely. One, to get an afternoon tea from the church and the family, but also for the fact of meeting somebody and talking to somebody different on the doorstep. So it's great. And here we have a picture of one of our youngsters getting stuck into, well, learning the instrument. Or I'm not sure whether he's trying to drown out the major, or he's trying to do the C scale, or I don't know. But here's Joel, a great picture. We do miss him. And a great picture, absolutely fabulous picture of mum and dad listening to me, really, and Joel listening even intensively. I don't know, but great picture. So if you've got your pictures, send them in wherever you are. On the one of the social media sites, it says pictures from your window. Fed up of that one, because you get all these people putting these lovely pictures from where their windows are. But send us your picture and we'll have a pictures from last week's session. You could be, you know, I tell you what, you could be going to the Shrubbers. I'd like to see that picture. No, not really. Not really. But anyway, send your pictures in. And I've been saddened this week, as I'm sure you have, as we've read the news and looked at it. And certainly this morning, by the situation in Minneapolis. You know, it's just, I can't find words for it. But the violence, the racism, the anger, the hurt. And it really does make me think why and where we stand with it. We're all children of God, aren't we? Every one of us, every human being. And I have to ask my question to myself. Am I prejudiced against my fellow human beings? Am I? Here's three hearts. Can you see that picture? Three hearts. Can you see the difference? Can you see what stands out? And I know because I chose them. One is a heart of a white person. One is the heart of a black person. And one is a heart of an Asian person. Can you tell? No, of course you can't tell. And should we be able to tell? No. Scripture says, 1 Samuel 16:7, the Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. From the voice, it says this, take no notice of his looks or his height. He is not the one, for the eternal one does not pay attention to what humans value. Humans only care about the external appearance, but the eternal considers the inner voice. And then from the message, but God told Samuel, who was looking to anoint a king, looks aren't everything. Don't be impressed with the looks and stature. I've already eliminated him. God judges persons differently than humans do. Men and women look at the face. God looks at the heart. It got me thinking. The Savage Nami have clearly stood against racism this week. And I'm really pleased that I've been able to just put some social media out there and to say that. The Salvation Army have been out in the community of Minneapolis, supporting that community. We stand as a family in Christ and for Christ, regardless of colour, regardless of creed, regardless of gender. I remind you again and again and again, and I do often, and I will again this morning. The greatest commandment in Matthew 22 says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor. Jesus told us that. Who is my neighbor? Well, that question has been answered as well by Jesus. Because he said, who is my neighbor? The one who had mercy on him, Jesus told him. Go and do likewise. Go and do likewise. Love your neighbor. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, everything about your being. And I want to say, how are your hearts this morning? As we look at that, as I have my little point on where we are and caring for those people around us, how are our hearts this morning? What does God see in your heart this morning? It's a tough ask, isn't it? Because it's about me as well. What does God see in my heart? But sometimes we need to ask ourselves the question. Man sees something on the outside, but God sees us. God sees every fiber of us. Everything, our joys, our hopes, our failures, our sin, our pain, our challenges, our anxieties. And so the list goes on. But you know, he holds us all in the spite of all above. He holds us all. He loves us all. He covers us. He protects us if we allow him to. So what is God seeing this morning? What are you sensing from God this morning? Here's a great song, and I want us to listen to it. And there's lines that say, to think that he hears 1,000 prayers each second, Yet he knows my voice and meets my every need. And the world would see his love for everyone. You are an amazing God. A lovely song by Lee Fisher. Beautiful song. Consider your hearts this morning. Pray for Minneapolis this morning, will you? Pray for the Salvation Army. Pray for the community. Pray for those who need to make a difference. For our country, the people who would want to have violence and cause. Why? But people, especially the Salvation Army, who are caring in these situations. Let's watch this song. Thank you. Father God, we just thank you this morning. We thank you that you are an amazing God, that you love each and every one of us, every part of our lives, parts of our lives that we may not be proud of, but you love us deeply and you care for us. Lord, we pray for Minneapolis this morning. We pray for the Salvation Army caring in that community. We pray for our own community. We pray for those who judge people wrongly because of the colour of their skin, because of the way they speak or they walk or whatever it is. Father God, let us not fall into that trap. Let us do what Scripture says. And sometimes that's tough stuff, but love our neighbor. It's a basic message. It's been said for 2,000 years. And yet it seems we've not learned. Just come to you this morning, Lord, and I thank you. And I ask, Father, for any part in my life that has been shown any sense of putting people down, or shown any sense of racism, or not loved somebody as I should, Lord, I ask for that forgiveness in my life. Nobody else's. I've no right to ask for anybody else's. And I just ask, Lord, that you forgive me and show me the errors of my way so I can be a better Christian. I can love my neighbor better. I can understand my neighbor better. So, Lord, hear the prayers we pray this morning. We thank you for this time to do this. And we ask this in your name, Lord, by no other power, by no other authority than that of Jesus. Amen. Amen. What an amazing God, isn't it? I need my clicker because I can't see the script. And I have to keep to the script. I really do. Over the weeks, I have had lovely messages. And I do want to thank people. And some of you that have not engaged in worship for many years, and some of the scores of years, that you've not gone to church, you've bypassed songs of praise on BBC, and you've not engaged in any way with God and with faith. And some of you have been coming to this site and to this morning, and you know, it's touched my heart because you've let me know, and I'm grateful, and I've prayed for you. And I want to say to you, if you're one of those this morning, welcome to worship, because that's what it's all about. And I'm saying, don't be a spectator, but be a participator. Get to know Jesus. I'm not worried if you get to know the Salvation Army or not. That's immaterial. But get to know the Creator who loves us, the person who told us to love our neighbor, the person who holds us and covers us. And I would say, allow God back into your heart. If you were once a Salvationist at a core that Judith and I were COs at, and you're no longer worshipping, you're no longer engaging in fellowship and partnership with God, hey, about time, isn't it? About time to get back. Get back on the bike. It's really important. Really is. And I was thinking this week, as I was praying for some of you and some of the messages I've received, Judith said I should get all these messages and put them in a little encouragement book, because it is just really encouraging for us to know that there are people out there who are coming back to the heart of worship. And Matt Redmond has written a great song. And so let's come back. Let's come back to worship. And maybe this morning you haven't worshipped for many, many years. Well, worship with this song, worship with God, and you're in the security and the privacy of your own home. You're in that secure place where you can engage with God, and God will speak to you. I believe that. So let's share this great hymn, I'm Coming Back to the Heart of Worship. Thank you.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the It's all about you, Jesus.
All about you, Jesus. Great song, isn't it? Great message. It really is. And thank you for the messages I'm receiving. One message said, oh, go on, don't stick to the script. You are naughty. All right? Because if I didn't keep to the script, it would be mayhem. And it would possibly be longer than an hour. Yeah. And I don't get feedback. So I don't know if you laugh at my jokes or not. I don't know. Anyway. But we're not. We're sticking to the script. But I need to say that because As you know, those of you who know me, I do keep a script on a Sunday when I'm preaching, but I do go slightly off tangent sometimes. And whilst I write the script, it is from God. I've got to say that. I don't like keeping just a script, but actually God does speak through it to me and makes clear what I want to say. So I'm grateful for that. I do add my own bits as well, but I do want to say that's, yeah, it's God's script, isn't it? It really is God's script. And here's another part of God's script. And this week I decided to pop in and see Peter and Sue. Peter had painted a shed and up a tree and up a ladder and all manner of things. I did ask about the health and safety of that. That's off the script, by the way. But Peter was fine. He didn't fall down, so he's okay. But had an opportunity to have a coffee with them, social distancing in the garden, and just share with them. And asked Sue to read the scripture this morning from Philippians. Here we go.
Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 to 20. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do. Forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us then who are mature should take such a view of things. And if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you. Only let us live up to what we have already attained. Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters, and just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. For as I have told you before and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven.
Amen. Thank you, Sue. Verse 13 in that scripture said, one thing I do. One thing I do, said Paul. What would be the one thing that you would like to do today? What would that be? Go out? Meet family? Have a hug? A holiday? What would that one thing be? David in Psalm says this, Psalm 27, verse 4. I am pleading with the Eternal for this one thing, my soul's desire, to live with him all of my days in the shadow of his temple. So David was clear. He wanted to be with God all of his days, to be a better Christian. Maybe that's our one thing, to actually be, you know, if everybody in the world just did one thing every day that made a difference to somebody else's life, regardless of who they were, what a difference that would make, wouldn't it? Act of random kindness. Just, wouldn't that be just great if we could do that? Let's sing together that great song from Hillsong's, Lord, I Come to You, Let My Heart Be Changed, Renewed, the power of your love.
Renew, flowing from the grace that I found.
What a great song, isn't it? One of my favourites, and looking at the trail there, some of your favourites as well. Delighted this morning. I'm going to single this person out, but I hope you don't mind. It's great to have Ruth and Mike Stannett tuning in this morning, sessional mates, servants of God. They were in Czech Republic for many, many years, serving the Lord in the Salvation Army. They're now over in Brussels, I think, but doing really important work. Ruth, you've blessed my heart seeing your name this morning. Thank you for being part of us. We pray for your ministry there in that part of God's kingdom and your family. Bless you both. Really good to hear from you. So, cuppa and chatter this morning. I thought we'd like to know a bit more about Tim Scott, don't you? Tim, great character, was my sergeant major and then couldn't cope with it anymore. No, not at all. But he's a great guy. So let's have a chat and a cuppa with Tim, shall we? So here we are with Tim in the garden of his house. Tim, you've been on lockdown, but you've been working from home?
Yep, been working from home for about 10 or 11 weeks now.
So what is your role?
So I work for London Underground. My job is to make sure that we keep operating as safely as possible. So train services, station operations, planning, contingencies, that all sits around my area.
That must be such a challenge with this pandemic, sort of that social distance.
It's interesting when you look at pictures and CCTV, taking a view of a situation from one aspect. If you look at the same situation from another aspect, it looks slightly different.
Yeah.
So we don't just operate on images, we look at reports from on the ground and what we can do. And as people are starting to understand what social distancing actually means, their behaviour has changed. People still need to get to work at the same time, so their companies and businesses are requiring them to travel all at the same time. And within that, what we're trying to do is maximise the train service so we can just get them on their journey so they're not having to wait. So we're managing people right from the moment they enter the station until the moment they leave.
Has there been a challenge for you to be working from home? Have you found that hard to do?
Yeah, I spend most of my days on conference calls. So Thursdays are the worst, about 5-6 hours worth of constant conference calls, all different meetings. I'm quite a people person. I like interacting with people, so I struggle when it's a disembodied voice on the end of a phone.
So what about faith in all of this? And where's that sat with you in these 11 weeks?
It's not really something that influences my work. My work is a professional thing. It influences how I approach people, building relationships with them, behaving, responding. It's me. Faith makes me who I am. So that's what I bring to my professional work. But what I have to do at work is just what I have to do at work, really. It doesn't change my work. It might change my approach, maybe different to other people, but we're just trying to get on with it, really.
I suppose because being a Christian, you're a Christian. You can't be half a Christian and a little bit of a Christian.
That's exactly
it. You're a Christian or you're not. There's no thin line there, is there?
That's exactly it.
What's going to be the new norm for you when we come out of this, do you think? What have you learnt in this experience? One for work and one for spiritual.
So work-wise, I know that I don't want to commute every day. So I'm going to be negotiating with my boss to do a bit of working at home because there are benefits as well, but that'll get getting the balance right. I'm trying to keep everybody's mind on some business as usual stuff. So it's making sure that when this pandemic finally comes to an end, or the impact on travel comes to an end, that we're not caught out by the day-to-day requirements. So hot weather has an impact on us. There's loads of things that I'm trying to keep going, so it's maintaining that. Spiritually, I've found that I've got time to think wider than Chatham. I really enjoy worship on Sunday mornings, but then I spend another hour on YouTube looking at different army meetings. I found one by accident, and they put a series of sermons online, so I'm actually taking time to listen to that teaching and those sermons. I found that really, really helpful. So just widening my thinking and widening my experience has been helpful.
Yeah. What one thing would you take out of the experience spiritually that you're taking
So the need to engage with God, not just to be in a different place and think that everything is fine, everything's the same. My faith needs to be active rather than a passive thing that I just turn up to the army, do what I do, and then go home on a Sunday and that's it. And maybe a couple of times during the week go to rehearsals. My faith needs to be and has to be a 24/7, 365 experience something that I need to work on. So when I'm feeling a bit down because I haven't spoken to people or I haven't seen people outside my household, I don't just let everything slide. You know, it's got to be something that's an active, day-to-day, live experience rather than just something I say, I'm a salvationist, I'm a Christian, and leave it at that. There's got to be more to it than that. And I'm still searching, still looking, still developing, still trying to see what's going ahead with faith and with my spiritual experience.
So what Bible verse, Tim, would you say has carried you through, or one that you...
So I haven't got a verse.
No.
Sorry, I'm going to be a little bit more than that.
That's fine.
You preached some time ago now about Psalms and asked us to look at those, and yeah. Band and songsters looked in their devotions at focusing on Psalms. And I find that Psalm 46, for me, is just hits the spot just at the moment. I'd like to read Psalm 46, but it's from Psalms Now. And it's really interesting when I read this. It's so appropriate for today and this time, not just the pandemic, but all sorts of other things. So it says, "Our great God is still our refuge and strength. He knows our problems and fears. Thus we have no business doubting him, even though the earth is convulsed in tragedy or its human masses threatened by ethnic hatred, disease, drugs, crime, or abuse. God continues to reign as all-wise and as almighty as ever. His eternal plan is not cancelled out by the whims of human leaders or the freakish accidents of nature. Nations will destroy each other. Civilizations will perish. The earth itself one day may become a smoking cinder. But God will not leave us. He is forever our sure refuge and strength. Just look around you, read the pages of history. Refresh your flagging spirit with a reminder of his great feats throughout the ages. And you will again hear him speaking. Relax, stop fretting, and remember that I am still your God. I still hold the reins of this world." God is here among us. He continues to be our refuge and strength. And that, not just for the pandemic, you just look at the news. There are so many areas where we feel that God is not there. Actually, God is still around. God is our refuge and strength, and must be that. And that's what I'm taking out of this.
Thanks, Tim. Great to have a cuppa and a chatter. You better get back to that Zoom call.
Absolutely. I don't know what they're doing without me. They're probably making the railway run better, but there we go.
Refresh your flagging spirit. Thanks, Tim. What a great cuppa. What a great chatter, wasn't it? And are we surprised that Scripture, which was written thousands of years ago, is relevant for today? No, because God has written it. God has written it. God is speaking through his word to us today. And thanks, Tim, for that conversation and for that encouragement. And that last verse in Psalm 46 is, "Be still and know that I am God. Be still." And again, this morning, we thank God for answered prayer, don't we? But we need to keep that going. We need to keep that conversation going with God. It's great to know that Mike Cordner is home. Lillian is pleased, I'm sure. But it's great that Mike is home, and we just ask God to continue to bless them and cover them and shield them with his mighty arms. We continue to pray for Alan Miners and the family as they prepare for the funeral service of joy and the Thanksgiving of life. We just ask God again, his hands are big enough to hold the whole family and to bless them through these days. And the funeral will be on Monday the 15th of June at 1:45 at Medway Crematorium, Bluebell Hill. So those, if you want to be there to be a guard of honour, or you'll be able to link up live, which is in your Chatham chatter. And also we pray for those of you listening after many years of reconnecting with faith, who are coming back to the heart of worship. We pray for you. Those struggling with being indoors and really struggling with all this situation, and it's having an effect on your health, we just pray for you deeply into your lives this morning. Let us use this lovely song to bring us to God. In a verse it says, it's an old hymn of the church, it says, "A little shrine of quietness, or sacred to thyself, where thou shalt all my soul possess, and I may find myself." Allow God to possess you this morning as we pray together, and the soft songsters will sing mid all the traffic of our way. Make our prayers before I bring our collective prayer to God this morning. Thank you. Let's pray together. Thank you, Father, for this morning. Lord, we find ourselves, as my Sergeant Major brings our prayer, we find ourselves in challenging times. It sometimes seems that the world is spiraling out of control. Lord, our eyes are on you. Help us to stay focused on you, to be still and know that you are God. Amen. Lord, hear our prayers this morning. We pray for Lindsay. We pray for those who are tuning in and just want to be blessed this morning and challenged, working in difficult situations, looking after family, finding the challenge of the situation hard. Lord, just come and bless. For those of our leadership within the Salvation Army who have to make decisions, Lord, we pray you'll bless them in the decisions that they're making at this time, to get us back to the normal, to encourage us and how difficult it is. To those of our country who are making decisions, who have to lead, we ask, Lord, in some way that you can break through some there and just allow your Holy Spirit to work in those lives. Such difficult, difficult decisions to be made. But we know that you're an all-powerful God, an omnipresent God, omnipotent God, who can be all and be everything if people put their trust and their faith in you. But this morning, we are still before you, Lord, and you speak to us and bless us. Come occupy, possess me, Lord, this morning. Possess us. We give you our prayers in the name of Jesus, and we thank you for all things. Amen. Amen. It's great to pray, isn't it? There's a sense of relief and refill. But let's sing again a song of praise, shall we? What a faithful God have I before I bring the word to you.
Oh Lord, I come before your throne of grace. I find rest in your presence and fullness of joy. In worship and wonder I behold your face, singing, what
Let me comfort those who suffer with the comfort you have given, and I will tell of your great love for as long.
Love that song. I would have it every week. What a faithful God have I. I will serve you the whole of my life. Great prayer, isn't it? That's what the Paul the Apostle was seeking, wasn't he? To serve the Lord, a faithful God. And he said he was seeking one thing in his life. He let go of his past and focused entirely upon following his Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Philippians 3. Sue read it to us earlier, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. One thing I do. What is the one thing you would do? We asked that earlier, didn't we? Many persons enjoy remembering the past, don't they? There are many things about the past which are important to me and to us. Surely there are many things about the past which are important to you also. And we've been looking at some of them. Last week we looked at it, what William Booth said about Chatham, you know, over 140 years ago. And our history, looking at some of our history. We look back, we like to look back, our past. And look at our past. And and remembering is really important. Because that is what makes us what we are today. It really is. Everything which has happened to us is a vital part of who and what we are. And looking at our history over these past few weeks, volumes of it in the office, it is important. It has shaped us and its core. As a congregation, a family here, we remember the past. We remember the myriad of contributions of those in the core from the past who've made such a huge difference. But what are we today? What are we doing today? Because what we are today is the result of the foundations laid for us previously. So what is the one thing to do that will make a difference? That somebody who will read our history and see it. But our past is also littered with the mistakes of daily living, isn't it? We have shed our tears and caused the shedding of tears. That is the life of learning and living. Paul's statement in Philippians 3:14 gives us that action which is essential for us, forgetting what lies behind. If God, who enables us to cover up the past, to forget the unforgettable, to raise those memories which paralyze us, those things that would stop us moving forward in Christ, God surrounds us with his love and shouts, "Your past is forgiven." Such redeeming grace, isn't it? It's forgiven, it's forgotten, it's covered. That is where we find peace. The peace enables us to forget, to begin anew. With Paul's words, straining ahead, forward, to what is ahead. The moment we surrender to God and ask the Holy Spirit to cleanse and release us, we then have a new future and new possibilities before us. We face the possibility of, sometimes for the very first time, being our true selves. God's future for us is unimaginable. God's future for us is filled with the ability to complete, to become, to have joy. Straining ahead, pressing on towards the goal. It is a marathon, not a sprint. Now, I brought something this morning. I'm going to get it.
Because I forgot. You can
still hear me? Oh, here it is. It's a marathon, not a sprint. And I had to bring these. Okay, I had to bring these. Marathon medals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, this old tubby has done 7 marathons. I was slightly lighter in those days. But, you know, running a marathon, I loved it. I enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it. But it wasn't the sprint. It was just the preparation, the constant going, the encouragement I got from the people. Everything about a marathon really tells us about Christian living as well, to some degree. Taking on energy, taking on water, pacing yourself, being encouraged by the people around you, taking that when you're feeling tired, being encouraged by those who are running with you. And then you see the finish post and you have that extra spurt because you know you're there. And it wasn't about the medal, it was about the achievement of doing. We are going for the prize, forgetting what lies behind. Verse 16, let us live up to what we have already attained. Verse 17, take note of those who live according to the pattern. What is the pattern? I said it earlier. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is, like it, love your neighbor as yourself. I can't say that enough. That is the greatest commandment. I can't say it enough. We are never out of the shadow of that verse, ever. Because that is what guarantees us the prize, the goal, as Paul says, eternal life. John 3:16, for God loved the world so much that whoever believes on him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Life eternal is more than arriving at the destination of heaven. Life eternal is quality of living that is present for us in our everyday, at all times. And we have a stark truth, verse 18. Many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their minds are on earthly things. Verse 20, but our citizenship is in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven. Amen. So back to the original question. What is the one thing you would do this morning? Verse 12, I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Forgetting what has happened, let's go on. Let's get ahead. Let's do the thing that God wants us to do. We know what it is, don't we? It is about Jesus. Let's share that great song that speaks of this truth. The verse says, for the joys and for the sorrows, the best and worst of times, for this moment, for tomorrow, for all that lies behind, fears that crowd around me, for the failure of my plans, for the dreams of all I hope to be, the truth of what I am, for this I have Jesus. For this I have Jesus. Let's reflect on this song. And make your commitment this morning, the one thing that you do this morning. And if it's the first time you've tuned into us this morning and you're not sure and your heart is pulsating, one thing this morning. I look at you and I say one thing, just ask Jesus into your life. Ask him to start that journey with you, forgetting what is past. Give the past to him. Give the past to him. Strain towards the prize. To the goal of having Jesus in your life. God bless you.
For the joys and for the sorrows, the best of times, for this moment, for tomorrow, for all that lies behind, fears the crowd around me, for the failure of my plans, for the dreams of all. For this, I have Jesus. tears that flow in secret in the broken times, and for the moments of elation, all the troubled mind, for all the disappointments, all the sting of all regrets, all my prayers and longings had seem unanswered.
Father God, we thank you for our worship this morning. We thank you that the truth is we do have you. Each one of us individually can say, I have Jesus. For those who have made that prayer this morning, Lord, I ask your blessing on their lives, for the Holy Spirit to anoint them, for the power of God to descend on their lives in a new and cleansing way, Father. Just ask, Lord, that you'll protect us all in these days which are challenging, and yet a blessing, we are receiving blessing upon blessing. So, Father, as we step out this week, may we know the truth of loving our neighbour, of doing that kind act this week that will make a difference to somebody's life. So I give you back every person who's listened this morning and those who will listen throughout the week. Bless them, Father. May your Holy Spirit dwell in their hearts and lives and continue to grow them in faith, each one of us, including the one standing. And may we know your truth and love and protection in these days. For we ask this in your name and we thank you for all things. Amen. Amen. Oh, where did that hour go? Hey, goodness me. Great time of worship. Thank you for worshiping with me this morning. It's a real pleasure to just engage with you in this way. I look forward to welcoming you next week. And we're going to look at a bit of music next week and interview somebody about music and talk about the music, the effect that Savage Army music has on their life. And that's going to be good. Our blessing this morning, I want to thank Emma Davis this morning. And she's part of Univoice. And you'll have seen on social media, a lot of people are doing this, I don't know what you would call it, but there's all the pieces, everyone's socially distanced and they're all singing their part and they put it together and then they produce this beautiful sound. Well, Emma's part of the Univoice and it's a lovely song called Be Still My Soul. And yeah, it really blessed me. And I know it's going to be a blessing for you this morning. So thanks, Emma, for sharing it with me. And you'll see her on singing away, as you will some few other people you might know. But until next Sunday, be still my soul. God bless you all. Look forward to seeing you. Thank you.